Hi, everybody. It's Dr. Tyler from Apex Brain Centers, and we're so excited to be talking to you about post-concussion screening that we started doing recently. And it's because a lot of times we see traumatic brain injuries and mild traumatic brain injuries, but typically after the fact. So whether someone had a brain injury last week or 10 years ago, we are usually seeing these after someone has already gone through this experience. So we are all about preventing these from occurring in the first place, and then also educating others on what to do if you do receive a concussion in order for you to recover appropriately. So we're going to go ahead and get started. So according to the CDC, anywhere from 1.6 to 3.8 million concussions occur in the U.S. every single year. So that ribbon that you see right there is for Traumatic Brain Injury Awareness Month, which is the month of March. And this typically is something that is not as well known, but now that we're becoming more advanced with our ability to understand the long-term repercussions of concussions, we really are starting to understand the importance of taking these in a little bit more serious manner, not only in prevention, but also in treatment world. So what we're going to be talking about today is, one, we're going to talk about what a concussion is and just what classifies as a concussion. We're going to talk about some symptoms that are associated with them, as well as a syndrome known as post-concussion syndrome. And then we're going to talk about the screenings that we do, as well as what parts of the brain are involved in those screenings. So what are we actually looking for or analyzing with these tests? And then also, what are some of the benefits of just training your brain in the first place? So what is a mild TBI? So mild TBI, the most common form is a concussion. So it just means that it's a mild traumatic brain injury. So it's still a serious topic because there are a lot of long-term side effects that can occur if these concussions are not treated or managed correctly. So when you're looking at younger brains versus adult brains, children who are younger are more likely to sustain a concussion and will have a longer recovery process. And we don't even need to have a hit to the head in order to have a concussion. So a concussion can occur from a blow to the body or chest, and can even happen with motor vehicle accidents where we have whiplash with the head coming back and forth because it still can cause that brain injury just from the impact on the other parts of the body. So some of the common signs and symptoms of a concussion, the most serious would be loss of consciousness. So if that happens, and a coach and a parent will know that this is, that warrants an emergency. So you really should be going, getting evaluated right away. But we also have a lot of symptoms that we typically disregard because they're not life-threatening, but they still are showing that there's parts of the brain that have been injured. So things like dizziness or light and sound sensitivity, severe headaches, nausea. And typically you can recover from your first concussion within about 2 weeks. But this depends on your brain's function in the first place. So depending on how your brain developed and what deficiencies and inefficiencies were in the brain will determine how well you recover from a brain injury. So what are some of the early consequences of a brain injury? So early on, what we really care about is second impact syndrome. So this is a term used for when we have a concussion and then we don't recover appropriately and have a second hit to the head right after that. This is extremely dangerous and life-threatening because what can happen is it can build a lot of pressure in the skull, increase your intracranial pressure, and cause swelling of the brain, and can not only lead to death, but also even if you do survive this, you may have long-term neurological inefficiencies and may even be handicapped. So this is something you definitely want to take seriously, which is why we really want to listen to our coaches and go and seek medical attention if necessary if you feel that you have had a concussion or someone that you care about has. So what is post-concussion syndrome? Post-concussion syndrome is when we have a concussion that we sustained and we don't recover from it. So this can happen from the first hit or from the first five. So there really can be a cumulative effect to this. And when we have post-concussion syndrome, it can last for years. So sometimes in the office, we're treating somebody who had a concussion or a history of concussion 10 years ago. And there's still a lot that can be done at that time. But obviously, when it comes to concussions, the closer to the date of the injury that you can, get, the more effective the treatment and the better you're going to respond to it. But some of the long-term effects of post-concussion syndrome can actually develop into seizure-like disorders. So we've seen quite a few of these in the office where you're having seizure-like disorders, but you're not having them on an EEG. So sometimes you're not even responding to the medications because the reasons for your seizures are not genetic. They're not typical type of seizures. It's just from constant trauma to the brain. And then on top of that, there's also a huge emotional component with concussions that many people don't realize. So as a parent or a coach, a lot of times we're so focused on the physical aspects of someone being able to return to play. But what we need to pay attention to is their affect, their mood. Are they interacting with their friends? You know, are they isolating themselves? So these are things that we want to look out for because concussion and anxiety and depression are closely linked, especially if there's been multiple injuries or injuries that have not regained full recovery. So what is chronic traumatic encephalopathy? Basically, this is what happens when we have multiple brain injuries over a period of time that are unmanaged appropriately. So this typically will happen in somebody who's been playing a sport for anywhere from 5 to 10 years with sustained injuries over and over again. So we will have inflammatory responses in the brain that will affect the proteins in there. And so it almost represents symptoms of dementia. So a lot of what's going on with the aging brain will occur faster for somebody who has had multiple hits to the head. So what are some of the benefits of pre-concussion screenings? Obviously, it's getting a baseline, right? So if we have two individuals and they both take a test, we really want to compare you to you because your strengths and weaknesses will be different from one individual to the other. So if we have a baseline of what the balance and coordination and all of these other components are, then when we compare it to the testing that we already have as a baseline, we can see huge drops and shifts, which is going to allow for us to know that we need to go and seek medical attention and get a further evaluation. It's also something that can really benefit anybody because these tests can be done at home. So if someone has a concussion, and even if it happens off field and a parent is concerned and they have this baseline, then this child can, even from home, take this test and to see if there's any huge shifts. Because as a parent and as a coach, we obviously want to think in the long term, so not only about what's happening right now, but how is this going to impact their life for the rest of their life. So this is something that can be extremely beneficial. Because the data comparisons just to an average 14-year-old versus your 14-year-old are very different. So we want to have those individualized numbers. So we're going to be talking about what some of the tests are and how they're performed and also how they relate to the brain and how we interpret the findings. So the first test is balance testing. Balance testing is done with multiple different positions. So first with the feet together. So what we're looking for is we basically place a phone on the chest, the person's eyes are closed, and what they're doing is they're trying to stay as still as possible. So what this does is it allows for the phone that has a device built inside of it that actually measures the amount of sway and movement, so the stability of that individual. What we're looking for here are two components, primarily the cerebellum, which is the back of our brain, and then our inner ear, which is the vestibular system. So these systems control our balance and coordination and even our eye movement. So these systems, you'll see inefficiencies, imbalance in multiple scenarios when these are not working appropriately. The next test is tandem stance. Basically, you put your one heel in front of the other toe and you try and stand as still as possible with the eyes closed. What we're looking for here is now we're separating out the sidedness to the cerebellum. So is it the right or the left side? So there really shouldn't be a huge distinction between these tests performed on either side. Even though we all have a dominant side, they should be fairly equal. So when it comes to brain training or any exercises you may do to improve this, there can be more specific exercises based on the weaknesses within the brain itself. There is one like balance stance. This is the last test in the balance testing, also performed with the eyes closed, so it's pretty tricky. But gives us really valuable information because, again, we're checking to see if there's that sidedness to the inability to balance. And a lot of times this is more difficult than people would think, because our ability to really know where we are in space can be affected by a lot of things, not only from developmental perspective, but from any type of injury we've ever had in our lifetime. And I don't know about you guys, but I've definitely fallen, hit my head a couple of times. So it's just part of childhood. We just kind of get up, brush off dirt, and keep going. So whenever we see inefficiencies in balance, we definitely want to pay closer attention to it, because it's not just about the balance itself. So balance is really what you're looking at, is the part of the brain that controls the balance. But that's what matters. And the cerebellum has been associated with many things, anything from even executive function, which is your ability to learn, pay attention, really perform well in school and academics, could be impacted by the cerebellum not working appropriately and not sending the right signals. Then when we're looking at athletic performance, you know, if we want to be the best player and we're training and working hard every day in practice, but our balance is poor, chances are our hand-eye coordination isn't as good as it could be either, because the systems are tied. And then obviously the most obvious factor is not having a fall risk. So if our balance is poor and it happens every time we close our eyes, you know, a sneeze is what it could cause for somebody to fall and hurt themselves. So we definitely want to make sure that these areas are strong. And if they're not strong, we train them to be strong. The next step is reaction time. Basically, you have your phone or device in your hand, and then you have to move the device whenever you see an orange light flash. A reaction time is extremely important, especially as children are developing and want to get a driver's permit and they want to be on the road, because if someone pulls out in front of you at the wrong time, if you have poor reaction time, the likelihood of you getting a car accident is going to escalate. So we can apply this to anything from daily life to also obviously academic and athletic performance. So let's talk about impulse control. Impulse control is going to be the hardest test for most individuals to take, especially if the brain is still developing. And it's because we have systems in the brain that build stronger connections as we grow older. So during this test, you have a device, and your job is to move the device when you see a check mark and to keep your phone still when you don't see that. So this is checking your ability to not follow any kind of impulse behavior and to really be able to compose and control yourself. So whenever we're looking at impulse control, we're also looking at not only our ability to really make good decisions, but even goal setting and achieving our goals. And these two parts of the brain that we're talking about here and this that are involved are the striatum and the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. So that means that there's a part on the inside of our brain and a part that's more in the front, and these parts communicate. And so this pathway gets stronger and stronger as we grow older. And this is why we have different age restrictions for certain activities, because our decision making has just not fully developed until a certain age. So it really keeps children and teenagers safe. And whenever we're looking at proper development, these systems should adapt. But there are plenty of adults that I'm sure you know that have impulse control issues. And a lot of it stems from neurodevelopmental delays. So just inability to really for your nervous system to develop appropriately. And there could be a lot of factors for that. And one of them is called primitive reflexes. So when we're born, we have reflexes built in within our system that keep us alive. Anything from our ability to grab a finger, if a finger's placed in our hand, to our ability to cry if we think we're falling. And these reflexes essentially are meant to keep us alive. And then as we develop, they're supposed to be integrated, so they no longer are occurring. But there will be times where we're dealing with someone with learning and behavior disorders, which is anything from ADD, ADHD, all the way into adulthood levels, which could even turn into addiction. That's when we're looking at these reflexes, and there will be plenty of adults who still have them. And then after a concussion, we can actually have a reoccurrence of these primitive reflexes, which is going to impair this impulse control to really develop appropriately for somebody. So let's talk about inspection time. You're provided with two tees, and essentially they're covered quickly. Your job is to select the one that was longer. So this is checking your processing visual speed. This is really useful for a classroom, but also for athletic performance. and has a lot to do also, in addition to visual processing, with attention. So our ability just to maintain simple attention while we're doing a task. The next test is memory test. You're given a task of working memory and recall memory. So your working memory is performed with a sequence that you have to follow, and it's a pattern that keeps adding on with intensity. And then while you're doing this, you have to be able to recall letters, which is your recall portion of the test. So we're using memory tests or memory skills every single day, especially as students. So if we're trying to read a book, we have to remember what we read on the page prior to that, which is our working memory, anything from doing math equations in our head. And then also if we're, you know, presenting right now, if we're presenting, it's of your ability to really make sure that you're not repeating yourself because you recall what you said and what you already did. So those are some of the areas that we evaluate during the SWAY testing, which is just a really great baseline to really assess your child's ability to do well executively as well as physically. So there's a lot of benefits to brain training, and some of them we've already gone over, but anything from attention, memory, processing speed, logic, reasoning, timing, coordination, impulse control, balance, and self-regulation. So I want to touch on that last one because it's extremely important. Self-regulation is your ability to control your emotions. So when our brain works better, we can do that. And I'm sure as a teenager, they have a really difficult time with self-regulation. But that is what we have for our pre-concussion screenings that we'll be doing through the office at Apex Brain Centers. And I really appreciate your time. And I hope that you're able to learn something from this presentation as well as pass it on to those who need to. And you can see that we have our contact information here for you. So don't hesitate to call the office, whether just speak for a free consult, or you can also email us directly if you have any questions or concerns. But thank you so much for your time. And I really hope that you guys leave with a better understanding of the repercussions of having multiple traumatic brain injuries and what we really can do to prevent them. But thank you so much for your time. And I hope that I will see you at another presentation.